Christ is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed. Alleluia.
Almighty God,
to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Glory to God in the highest.
And peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen.
The Lord be with you. Also with you, let us pray. Almighty and everlasting God, who in the Paschal mystery established the new covenant of reconciliation, grant that all who have been reborn into the fellowship of Christ's body may show forth in their lives what they profess by their faith, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
A reading from the book of Acts. But Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed them. You are Israelites. Listen to what I have to say. Jesus of Nazareth, a man attested to you by God with deeds of power, wonders, and signs that God did through him among you, as you yourselves know, this man handed over to you according to the definite plan and foreknowledge of God. You crucified and killed by the hands of those outside the law, but God raised him up, having freed him from death, because it was impossible for him to be held in its power. For David says concerning him, I saw the Lord always before me, for he is at my right hand, so that I will not be shaken. Therefore my heart was glad and my tongue rejoiced. Moreover, my flesh will live in hope. For you will not abandon my soul to Hades, or let your Holy One experience corruption. You have made known to me the ways of life. You will make me full of gladness with your presence. Fellow Israelites, I say to you confidently of our ancestor David, that he both died and was buried, and his tomb is with us to this day. Since he was a prophet, he knew that God had sworn with an oath to him that he would put one of his descendants on the throne. Foreseeing this, David spoke of the resurrection of the Messiah, saying, he was not abandoned to Hades, nor did his flesh experience corruption. This Jesus God raised up, and of that all of us are witnesses. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Psalm 16. Protect me, O God, for I take refuge in you. I have said to the Holy One, you are my God, my good above all other. All my delight is upon the godly that are in the land, upon those who are noble among the people. But those who run after other gods shall have their troubles multiplied. Their liberation of blood I will not offer, nor take the names of their gods upon my lips. O God, you are my portion and my cup. It is you who uphold my lot. My boundaries enclose a pleasant land. Indeed, I have a godly heritage. I will bless you, O God, who gives me counsel. My heart teaches me night after night. I have set you always before me. As he is at my right hand, I shall not fall. My heart, therefore, is glad, and my spirit rejoices. My body also shall rest in hope. For you will not abandon me to the grave, nor let your Holy One see the pit. You will show me the path of life. In your presence, there is fullness of joy, and in your right hand are pleasures forevermore.
A reading from the first letter of Peter. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. By his great mercy, he has given us a new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and into an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you, who are being protected by the power of God through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. In you rejoice, even if now for a little while you have had to suffer various trials, so that the genuineness of your faith, being more precious than gold, that though perishable is tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor when Jesus Christ is revealed. Although you have not seen him, you love him. And even though you do not see him now, you believe in him and rejoice with an indescribable and glorious joy, for you are receiving the outcome of your faith, the salvation of your souls. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Holy Gospel of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ according to John. When it was evening on the first day of the resurrection, the first day of the week, the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the Jews. Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." And after he had said this, he showed them his hand and his side. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." But Thomas, who was called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hand and put my fingers in the mark of the nails and my hand in his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. It. although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your hand here, see my hand. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe." Thomas answered him, "Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe." Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that though believing, you may have life in his name. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Christ.
May the words of my mouth and the meditations of your heart be always acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our redeemer. Please note, my friends, this is the second Sunday of Easter, not the first Sunday after Easter. Easter is a season of seven Sundays, which then culminate on the following Sunday with the day of Pentecost, which is marked by the gift of the Holy Spirit and numerous early Christians speaking in tongues. During Eastertide and the gospel readings for several weeks, we hear about various of the resurrection appearances and the emergence of an ever larger community of believers. The day of Christ's ascension is observed on the Thursday after the fifth Sunday of Easter, and generally the sixth Sunday of Easter is observed as the Sunday of the Ascension. Eastertide is distinctive in that most parishes do not have a reading from the Hebrew Scriptures. Instead, we have two New Testament readings in addition to the Gospel. Today's first reading is from the Book of Acts, which was written by the evangelist Luke as a companion book to his gospel and details the life and ministry of the early church. Today, we hear a part of the second chapter of Acts in which Peter proclaims the resurrection of Jesus. The second reading in Eastertide is from one of the epistles offering theological perspectives from early Christian leaders. This Sunday, we read part of the first chapter of the letter of Peter in which Peter summarizes the meaning of the resurrection. By God's mercy, we've been given a new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and into an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for us who are being protected by the power of God through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last days, the final days, the eschatological moment. Today's gospel reading is from the 20th chapter of John's gospel, in which Jesus makes two resurrection appearances to his disciples a week apart and features the apostle Thomas, sometimes called Doubting Thomas, who would not believe his brother disciple's story of seeing the resurrected Jesus until he did as well. I've long believed that Doubting Thomas is seriously mislabeled. Due to this story, rather than respecting Thomas's initial skepticism and his desire for more evidence of what was surely the greatest alleged theological breakthrough in human history, the church in general, and preachers in particular, have tended to demean Thomas's doubt and to criticize his insufficiency of faith. I would propose that it is in fact time to reframe our understanding of Thomas the Apostle. Let us set aside the moniker of Doubting Thomas and instead embrace the vision of Discerning Thomas. Yes, even Discerning Thomas, role model for lay and ordained ministry in the 21st century. Recall, if you will, the circumstances of his life and ministry. The events of Good Friday cast Thomas and all of the followers of Jesus into a period of fear, grief, anxiety, and utter uncertainty about the future of their lives and ministries. Were they even to have ministries? the Jesus whom Thomas had known and loved, followed and proclaimed, was dead. Dead by the merciless death of crucifixion. Dead through the betrayal carried out by a fellow disciple. Dead through the complicity of both secular Roman and Jewish religious authorities. Those of us who have experienced a serious loss will probably remember that the grief process often surfaces emotions such as grief, shock, denial, anger, anxiety, depression, and despair. Grieved people are not infrequently affected by waves of emotion. Sometimes they are even deluded or confused when initially confronted by the loss of someone very important to them. To say the least, the loss of Jesus on Good Friday was a devastating and profound bereavement for his followers. Their grief might well have led them astray in many directions. The skepticism, the doubting, the discerning which Thomas manifests might as easily have been a corrective to mass hysteria or group denial. Today, we can be grateful that Thomas took the time and risked the disapproval of his friends and sought the verification of what the others already seemed to agree upon. To his, he was ultimately able to proclaim with clarity and conviction an affirmation which today we have heard and may share: my God and my Lord. I cite discerning Thomas as a role model for our ministries in the 21st century because we are living in an era of unprecedented social and ecclesiastical change. Indeed, I wrote that last sentence some while ago before the current pandemic with its fearsome statistics, government mismanagement, painful and almost incomprehensible losses, devastating challenges to our employment and our finances, and the utterly disorienting and challenging phenomenon of social distancing in our personal, social, vocation, and educational and religious lives. Even deathbeds, funerals, burials, memorial services, and family gatherings are virtually on hold, out of bounds, and we know not for how long. We're going to need a great deal of leadership, bipartisan collaboration, institutional adaptation, self-sacrifice, prayer, generosity of spirit and purse, flexibility and discernment to even begin to pursue the new beginnings and to grieve the losses and changes which will face us in every dimension of our lives. The evolution of these changes will probably take years, not months. Of two things I am certain. One, along with most institutions in our nation and the world, the Episcopal Church and the Anglican Communion, and indeed virtually all religious bodies, are going to be very different in the decades ahead. We've already begun to learn about the possibilities as well as the challenges of virtual worship, music, fellowship, and pastoral care. Our buildings, our staffing, our leadership, our finances, and much more, most likely will never be quite the same, perhaps very different indeed. And secondly, the world, the nation, the state of New Jersey and Asbury Park and environs need A, the gospel of Jesus Christ, which proclaims love, truth, and justice for all people. B, the Anglican faith, which draws upon scripture, tradition, reason, and human experience and the human mind to discern the truth, to celebrate God's love, and to bring redemption, forgiveness, and hope to all people. And C, Trinity Episcopal Church in Asbury Park, where the Eucharist is celebrated and we find food for our souls, where beautiful music and a beautiful building comforts our hearts, where pastoral care is generously available, where families and children find welcome, embrace, and learn about Jesus, where the hungry, the homeless, and those in need find food, shelter, and non-judgmental community. And a community which encompasses all sorts and conditions of people, and so very much more. Alleluia. Christ is risen. The Lord is risen indeed. We believe in one God,
the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshiped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and we look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
With all our heart and with all our mind, let us pray to God. For the peace from above, for the loving kindness of God, and for the salvation of our souls, we pray to you, risen Christ.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the peace of the world, for the welfare of the Holy Church of God, and for the unity of all peoples, we pray to you, risen Christ.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our bishop and for all the clergy and people, we pray to you, risen Christ.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our president, for the leaders of the nations, and for all in authority, we pray to you, risen Christ.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the good earth which God has given us, and for the wisdom and will to conserve it, we pray to you, risen Christ.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the aged and infirm, for the widowed and orphans, and for the sick and the suffering, we pray to you, risen Christ.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the poor and the oppressed, for the unemployed and the destitute, for prisoners and captives, and for all who remember and care for them, we pray to you, risen Christ.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all whose lives are closely linked with ours, especially those we name either silently or aloud. We pray to you, risen Christ.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all those who suffer in body, mind, or spirit, especially those we name either silently or aloud. We pray to you, risen Christ.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all the departed, especially those we name either silently or aloud. We pray to you, risen Christ.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For deliverance from all danger, violence, oppression, and degradation, we pray to you, risen Christ.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And so, by your grace, in communion with the Blessed Mary, the God-giver, and all our saints, let us offer ourselves and one another to the living God through Christ.
To you, O Lord.
Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, peace I give to you. My own peace I leave with you. Regard not our sins, but the faith of your church, and give us the peace and unity of that heavenly city where in the Holy Trinity you live and reign now and forever. The peace of the Lord be always with you. I sorely wish that we were able to be gathered in a place where we could at least give one another a safe virtual sign of peace, a nod, a wave, a peace sign. But the best we can do is to relish in the fact that we at least can see members of our community here on the screen for every major service at the church. And I know that people are staying in touch by telephone and in other ways on Facebook and other means. And I hope that if anyone does have a pastoral need, that you won't hesitate to reach out to the parish telephone number or to the emails of the clergy and lay leadership team, or even to seek out one of us who is on Facebook as a starting place for being in touch. I'm incredibly grateful to our parish administrator, Jill Osis, who with the help of some other splendid colleagues has been managing to facilitate these services online with, I call her the producer, director, and a whole lot of other things, as well as the tech manager and the project manager. But she is a remarkable, remarkable leader in our parish. And I never cease to be amazed when I get an email at 11:31 p.m. and she's still working after I've been asleep for 3 hours. But she's just an extraordinary resource, and our wardens and vestry and our deacons and so many others are helping us to carry on as best we're able. One thing I want to say in the midst of the announcements is we're very aware of the financial stresses that are on so many people who are not on unemployment or are not being paid or have not yet received their government grants. And I pray that some of those resources will get better or more efficient. But I have to also say that this is also a challenging time for churches and synagogues all over America as we continue to have to pay our bills. And if you are able to keep up your pledge or make a special gift or just to send in a check out of goodwill and thanksgiving, that will help us carry on. The diocese has made some accommodations for parishes. The pension fund has made some concessions for clergy pensions that will be helpful when our new priest in charge arrives at the beginning of June. But overall, it's a tight time for churches. And I fear many of the very small ones, this may be the last gasp of a real period of decline. I give thanks that there's so much life and leadership and goodwill and fellowship in this parish, and I pray that soon we will be able to both share worship and music and fellowship back here in our beloved space. But in the meantime, let us with gladness present the offerings and oblations of our life and labor to the Lord.
Thank you.
the great thanksgiving. The Lord be with you and also with you. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give God thanks and praise. It is right, a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. But chiefly are we bound to praise you for the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. For he is the true Paschal Lamb who was sacrificed for us and has taken away the sin of the world. By his death, he has destroyed death. And by his rising to life again, he has won for us everlasting life. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Glory and honor and praise to you, holy and living God, to deliver us from the power of sin and death and to reveal the riches of your grace. You look with favor upon Mary, your willing servant, that she might conceive and bear a son, Jesus, the Holy Child of God. Living among us, Jesus loved us. He broke bread with outcasts and sinners, healed the sick, and proclaimed good news to the poor. He yearned to draw all the world to himself, yet we were heedless of his call to walk in love. Then the time came for him to complete upon the cross the sacrifice of his life and to be glorified by you. On the night before he died for us, Jesus was at table with his friends. He took bread. Gave thanks to you, broke it, and gave it to them and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, as supper was ending, Jesus took the cup of wine. Again, he gave thanks to you, gave it to them, and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you and for all for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Now gathered at your table, O God of all creation, and remembering Christ crucified and risen, who was and is to come, we offer to you our gifts of bread and wine and ourselves a living sacrifice. Pour out your Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the body and blood of Christ, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Breathe your Spirit upon the whole earth, and make us your new creation, the body of Christ given for the world you have made. In the fullness of time, bring us with the ever-blessed Virgin Mary and all your saints, from every tribe and language and people and nation, to feast at the banquet prepared for the foundation of the world. Through Christ and with Christ and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, to you be honor, glory, and praise forever and ever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to pray. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Hallelujah. Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast. Hallelujah.
The gifts of God. For the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you. And feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. I think by now many of you know that Bishop Stokes has asked that we not physically receive the bread and wine of communion, whether we are recording a service or joining in with the service by videotape. Instead, he reminds us that we can receive spiritual communion, and it is in that spirit of spiritual communion which we hope feeds each of us this day. The post-communion prayer. God of abundance, you have fed us with the bread of life and cup of salvation. You have united us with Christ and one another, and you have made us one with all your people in heaven and on earth. Now send us forth in the power of your Spirit, that we may proclaim your redeeming love to the world, and continue forever in the risen life of Christ our Savior. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be upon you and remain with you forever.
To love and serve the Lord. Alleluia, alleluia.
Thanks be to God. Alleluia, alleluia.